Hey guys, here's another episode of Regurgitated Content where I just talk about something else that was online and, you know, give my opinion on it or something. And today I kind of wanted to try to talk about one of my favorite, like, musicians, John Frusciante. And if you don't know who he is, he is the guitarist for the Red Hot Chili Peppers. He's the current one. He like wasn't the original one, but then when their original guitarist passed away, he went on. So he was like their second guitarist, I guess you could say, right? And he's the one that kind of brought them into the popularity. What with Blood Sugar Sex Magik, he was like kind of the reason the band blew up, I guess, if you want to say that. And so I know after Blood Sugar Sex Magik, he like kind of fell off because he didn't want to deal with all the popularity that album brought them, the Chili Peppers. If you're a big fan of Chili Peppers, you already know all this, but whatever. But so, and this is my rendition of the story. I could be leaving a lot out, but yeah, basically, he left after Blood Sugar Sex Magik, and then they brought in Dave Navarro. And during this time, he was having, like, a really bad drug habit. And you could look at, like, his albums. And I'd love to, on the Patreon, review all of his albums, because all of his albums are so, like, unique to, you know, like the periods of times that he was in. Like, you could look at Niandra Lades and usually just t-shirt, and you could tell like it's his first album, whatever. But then you could look at Smile from the Streets You Hold, and you can definitely tell it's a album just made for I think what he just said, just for heroin money. Like, he made it just to get money for heroin. Right now I wanted to watch like interview some snippets of an interview of him from, I don't even know what language this is. I really don't care to, like, you know, fully describe everything, but he's you could tell he's on drugs. You could tell he's, you know, still making his weird music. And this was, I'm pretty sure this was right after Blood Sugar Sex Magik, you know, when he was probably about to leave, or he wasn't even with the band, maybe, you know. But yeah, let's check out the video. Well, it says 1994, so, you know.
Problemen hebben met een heroïneverslaving. Via tussenkomst van een wederzijdse vriend, Dick Root, sporen we hem op in Venice, Californië, in het huis van John's vriendin Tony. In het woongedeelte van het eenvoudige tweekamerappartement treffen we tussen de stapel CD's een proefpersing aan van Frusciante's soloalbum, dat binnenkort uit zal komen.
He's got that Michael Jackson, like, drugged up look to him, you know? That's the kind of way I, like, see him as right there. God, he looks so on drugs right here.
It was my last time ever playing a sport, baseball, and this guy who I thought was a real jerk, I sat in the outfield and made up a song about how I'd like to, how I thought he should die. So I went home and I filled up a tape with 45 minutes worth of songs. And ever since I've been writing songs, lately I've been writing a lot. I write a lot in notebooks. Like, I go through like a notebook every couple of weeks. And just do writing of all kinds.
Dude, I remember when my...
I do just
When my brother was in like his drug stupor, he would write stuff like this.
Do you remember any of those songs that you wrote when you were nine? That song about the guy.
No. I know that one was called "Fuck You to Jose."
You wouldn't know how to play anymore now.
No, all my songs back then were played like this. But I assumed that I was tuned so that sounded like this. But I have no way of knowing. I didn't know what the fuck I was doing. But yeah, it was. I drew up a little single that had a guy stage diving like upside down in the air, and our single had five songs, like the LA punk rock group Mad Society did, who had a 9-year-old singer. But the single was never made. So those songs are just flying around the universe.
Would you mind playing some stuff from that you recently wrote?
Sure. But like, when I do shows for this album, I'm gonna do stuff mostly from the age 14 and now.
I'm so assuming this was while he was doing "Smile from the Streets You Hold." Or this could be from Nyanderlades. It sounds like it could be from Nyanderlades as well. Or usually just a t-shirt. Really, if you listen to Nyanderlades, it sounds a lot like this. A little bit more better production, but pretty much like Nyanderlades. God, but he looks so fucking drugged up, like wearing his long sleeve shirts to hide the scratches and the marks. It was nice. No, it was. It was very nice. Damn. God, voice of an angel. See, this is probably him with in Blood Sugar Sex Magic, where he looked pretty healthy. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Talking a little bit about the point when you left the Chili Peppers?
No.
Why did you leave the band?
Because, I mean, there's a bunch of reasons. For one thing, like a year before I quit, like, they knew I wanted to quit. And me and Flea once took a drive to a park after the first 2 months of touring the American tour, which I was just miserable on. Like, I broke the band code of not bringing your girlfriend along on tour because I just couldn't do it without her.
But he didn't want to tour, like, he didn't want to be that big.
Whenever, you know, whenever I was on stage and looking at Flea or looking at Chad or looking into my amp and looking at the, you know, at all the shapes of sound floating around. But I wasn't happy with anything else. So me and Flea took this drive to the park after that tour, and we were sitting there, and he said, is there anything you like about being in the band? And I said, no, there's nothing I like about being in the band at all. And he goes, nothing. And then I said, nothing except for playing with you. I love you. That's why I'm in the band, because I love
the And that's why he came back to the band, because of Flea. Like, now, that's why he's back in the band.
Stay in the band if you're not happy. He says that, but then he forgets it, and, you know, and then, like, for a year, I was doing it, and then they're surprised when I quit, when he knew, even back then, that I wanted to quit, you know? But it's just that we were so close to each other, and it's just like, it's like his marriage or something, you know? If somebody says they want to break up, you don't keep it in your mind all the time when you're with them. So I enjoyed, you know, Flea, but that's about it. I just... You know, is that enough? You need me to say more?
I don't know. You think that's enough?
You have any questions to ask me about it? I mean, I could go into specific things and I could insult people, but...
God. It's like drugged up teeth.
No, I've done it enough.
Oh. You are not in public, though, have you?
No, no. This is the first bit of press I've done since I quit the band. Turn around in a circle. I joined the band, I couldn't believe that they, like, wanted to be this other thing than they were, you know? Like, they didn't think, like, I thought of them as huge stars, you know? But to them, they weren't famous yet, you know, and they hadn't made it yet.
And see, he already loved the band, and whatever, you know? He wanted them to stay just as popular as they were. But when they became, like, as big as they did for... For Blood Sugar Sex Magic, it killed him. He didn't want to be that popular. He didn't want to be world popular.
I found out that this record that we had been recording, this music that me and Flea had just gone nuts over for, you know, a few months, was actually going to be in record stores, and there would be a bunch of people going and buying it and then putting it on and listening to that music that we made. It had never occurred to me, literally, I'm serious. It had never entered my head. It was never a thought that went through my head that said,
yeah,
people are going to buy this. And
he never thought he wanted to be, he didn't want to be famous.
Like when I first said it, I said all over the country. And then I realized, Jesus, all over the world. And I said it to Flea like five different ways. And he was going, yeah. He had it in the dimension that the music existed as energy, and not the place that the music existed as words or as a thing to entertain people. Really in a heavy place when we recorded the album, just like I heard ghosts on the whole record, you know.
You mean in a weird place spiritually?
Yeah, it was just a fun place to be. Uh-huh. Like I heard ghosts on the whole record, and I'd always say to people when we were playing it for them, we were recording them, I'd say, don't you hear those ghosts? Listen. And Flea would go, John, not everybody hears them. Just we hear.
Dang. Funky Monks.
Them once, and you were real lively and up.
Oh, I wasn't happy at all, man.
No?
No, not at all.
Why not?
Because I didn't want to be there doing press at all.
And he's still the same like that. Like,
three-quarters of the way into
I think
it.
Even now, when he wanted to come back to the band,
him and Anthony would have
It was an agreement, like, you have to come do press. And he was like, all right, I can do this.
Like, I feel that when you speak about things, you're diarrheaing all over them, you know? You just ruin whatever you're talking about. And I felt like I was diarrheaing all over this art that was really important to me. And I hated being told that I was a rock star. Oh, so I was saying, so Anthony would not, he felt like he couldn't joke around anymore because I was getting so serious because I was so angry about the whole press thing and the whole rock star thing. And then he would have looked like he didn't have any integrity if he would have just spouted off. So it was a really bad combination, you know? And he was scared to say anything like he usually did, which was his thing. And so it was just awful.
You mean he was trying to compensate for...
No, he just imitated me.
Oh?
He would just imitate me, so then, you know, because if I say, like, Van Gogh, blah, 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 and then he says, whip out your cock and show it to my mother, like, you know, it doesn't go together.
Yeah, nope, does not at all.
Cool person, or you're going to become, like, you're going to become a good nothing. You're going to know how to be nothing and really understand it, or you're going to be a bad nothing and just a piece of shit. And there's not really any in between if you're a rock star, you know?
That's true, I guess.
So what did you think when you heard the news of Kurt Cobain's death?
Dad? Oh, death?
Death, sorry.
I cried. I don't know why. I don't like his music or anything. It was... awful, you know, but about his baby, I don't want to talk about that.
No.
I just don't think he has very many guts. I just don't see why he wouldn't want to see his daughter grow up, you know.
Oh, yeah, because Kurt Cobain committed suicide.
What we were saying, like, people just start thinking of themselves too much,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's so much that they become conscious of the world of video and the world of this and that and the world of fame. They just think of themselves, and no matter who you are, whether you're a rock star or you're a garbage man, if you're thinking of yourself all the time, you're not going to be very good at what you do.
This is
or
true.
You're not going to be a good nothing. How could you?
Mm-hmm.
Like with a baby, you can slam dance with them when they're two and they'll love it, and you can tell them funny jokes when they're two and they'll love it, and you can teach them about how everybody's an idiot and they'll love it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it doesn't occur to a lot of people how intense that is, how beautiful it is.
He's right, it is beautiful to
everything I like my
show a child something new, you know.
That's what it says on
his
front.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's the smartest person I've ever
met. And he did dedicate his first album to Clara, Flea's daughter, right there.
That's her first boyfriend. John got that for her for her birthday.
Ah, yeah!
What I was thinking about, you know, when I heard about Kurt Cobain's death, and, you know, we just experienced River Phoenix's death, and before that, Hillel Slovak's death. There's this self-destructive thing that happens to people, you know, in this business or something.
Everybody dies.
Yeah, okay.
I don't think it's that big of a deal.
No?
For instance, in River's case, I think it's more of a shame that that he was doing something he didn't like. I think it's more of a shame that he was born than he died. Because he didn't like this life. He didn't like this place.
He's talking about River Phoenix, Joaquin Phoenix's brother, who I believe was the original guitarist for the Chili Peppers.
I don't care if I die right now.
Right? Or no?
Doesn't mean I'm
no, Hillel Slovak, wasn't he? I don't even know now.
I think that's the only way to love life. It starts to separate the boys from the men.
I just know they were like really good friends with River Phoenix.
Got that inside of them, and who doesn't? You know, that's when somebody becomes a good musician and the other person doesn't, is because one is all concerned with the future and the past, you know, and one is just right here, right now. excited.
His arms are fucked up. Look at that.
And sad and doesn't give a fuck. Some people are sad and they're like, oh no, this leads to death.
Acteur River Phoenix, bekend van films als Stand By Me, Running On Empty en My Own Private Idaho, was tot aan zijn dood goed bevriend met de Chili Peppers en John Frusciante.
I live underground in this country. In the sense of like, you know, the more experimental, you know, level of lifestyle, which is just not as interconnected with business or consuming, just what you need, minimalist. And that's provided me with just a different view on it all.
That was short.
Well, I mean, the problem is that I believe very much in the Native American Indians who really owned this land beforehand. And their idea was that a photo can take your soul.
Mm-hmm.
And it scares the shit out of me, too, to be frank.
To be in front of a camera?
Oh, so frightening.
Oh.
That's why when I'm on set, I never look at the camera. Mm. You don't look at the camera.
That's funny.
I'm very frightened right now. I'm dealing with it somehow.
Yeah, you're dealing with it quite well.
But I really am frightened.
Oh.
This is very... yes, yes.
That's me all the time. I'm always frightened. But I'm dealing with it right now.
Brewski hops. Brewski hops yeast. The business always goes for what you do best. And I've just made myself do best in the way I've wanted to. So if they get recognition, like at the Venice Film Festival, the Toronto Film Festival, wherever it is, you know, in France and in Holland, when critics start speaking up and they believe in something, then you have the power to get blowjobs, basically, from the corporate leaders.
Mm-hmm.
I found myself being blown by America's film corporations. It's nice.
Yeah?
Yeah. I come in their fucking lens.
I still want to ask you something about that, what I just said, that self-destructiveness. Because I once talked to Bob Forrest right after he did a big show in Holland, and he climbed up some very high thing, almost fell, and he survived, and
yeah,
he was very that. Crazy.
He's wearing my clothes.
He was wearing your clothes?
That whole tour. Okay, you want me to say something soulful?
Yeah.
Drugs, I'm a junkie, and I love shooting up, and,
mm-hmm.
and that means I'm self-destructive, and, you know, is that good enough?
At least he's self-aware, I guess.
Was it a true statement, or?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, oh yeah, he's drugged up. Look at that. I still love his voice, though, even though it's like drug-ridden and rotting. It's still got like this uniqueness to it.
I just look at the pictures, I don't read it. I've just always loved looking at pictures of David Bowie. The only stuff I would read is when I was 17 and I would buy coke on the streets every day. I would, whatever days I, you know, I was starving, so I didn't have money, but I would manage. And days that I couldn't manage, I would since I really wanted to do coke, I would just look up all the sections in the Bowie biography that I had in the index where it says cocaine. And then just look up all the parts about cocaine and read them, so I would feel like I was on coke.
That's one way to do it.
Looking at the pictures.
Why did you?
That's him and Iggy Pop.
All right. Uh huh. It's a nice one.
They think something's funny.
Why did you want to be on coke so badly then?
Because it's great.
That's a dumb question, because it's great. It made me feel great.
And plus, I just thought it was cool. I just
all this stuff when he was on a lot of coke, and that stuff, and that feeling and that image is just the whole reason I got into rock and roll in the first place. Like, bisexuality and drugs were the two things in life that I related to rock and roll in my overall image of it when I was 9 or 10 years old.
It's interesting.
I got into punk rock. You know, that was my whole, that was the whole world that I felt within me that wasn't
so my,
me at school that made me feel
my
like
pronouns, bisexuality / drugs.
That was part of everyday living, and that gave me a reason to live, to feel like I actually did have a place where other people felt the same feelings for life that I did. And so when I was 17, I had never really done any drugs in my whole life, and moved to Hollywood and decided that instead of practicing guitar 10 to 15 hours a day, which is what I had been doing for 5 years, I was just going to live life and do cocaine and wear makeup every day. I wore makeup every day then. And just, you know, I would go buy it from Mexican guys and be wearing, like, full makeup, you know, and pink pants. And
I know he does.
I thought I was cool all the time. I would argue with guys I didn't even know, just like that.
He dresses up like a woman for his album cover for Nine Underlaid, so.
About this drugs thing, what it is in people, or in somebody like you or others, there's many others, that they have to have add this something to their body that changes them and alters them.
Well, every second alters you. Every single thing you've ever seen alters you.
Yeah.
Everything you eat alters you.
Okay, but that's an extreme way of altering yourself.
I don't think so. I think a parent yelling at you is an extreme way of altering yourself.
Mm.
I think somebody kicking you in the thighs is your one you look up to as being the role model of masculinity. I think that alters you.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're referring to your own parents or what?
No,
oh.
Not necessarily. I'm referring to everybody's
parents kicked them in the thighs.
You know, make some sort of mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
And have some sort of sense of carelessness when it comes to developing their child's sexuality.
Mm-hmm.
And their brain, like, it's what's considered smart to the world and parents is like memorizing things and doing good in school, and what I've come to find is what smart is being able to trip out, you know?
Hell yeah.
That's using more parts of your brain. That's your subconscious at work. That's lining up thoughts and doing really intense things to your whole existence.
Well, those are atypical thoughts.
And in all your other lives that are going on simultaneously. That's what smart is, not just memorizing something. A monkey can do that. So drugs just help that. I did it my whole life. Kiss was the first time I really tripped out on music, you know, where it just really took me to a magical place.
Mm-hmm.
And drugs are just...
There was like Kiss.
Go along with that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think of it as any sort of heavy alteration that hurts you. It's like, oh, if I snort a line of coke, like, oh God, that was terrible. I wish I hadn't done that in front of you. Oh,
oh.
Awful. Are you okay? I think I'm gonna be okay.
Okay, but now you just said you're shooting up. You're using heroin. I mean, what about that? That's something pretty heavy, isn't it?
People say so. I don't know what that means, really. Like, I don't think of it as being any sort of naughty thing or anything.
No, heroin's not naughty.
It's just
a
way of making sure you stay in touch with beauty instead of letting the ugliness of the world corrupt your soul.
Mm-hmm. Heroin keeps things in your mind beautiful.
Mm. And you don't care if that destroys your body or doesn't it?
Destroy my body. I feel great. If I didn't feel great, I'd change the way I live. I'd start running or something.
Yeah,
I'd feel great.
Dumbasses.
Have lots of energy. I'm writing all the time, writing music all the time, developing my brain. appreciation of art of all kinds.
That's what drugs do.
And being a nicer person. Always working on being a nicer person.
And so it's not a habit that you would want to stop?
No. No, even if addiction didn't exist, I'd still do it exactly the way I've done it.
Aan het eind van het gesprek laat John een nummer horen van zijn nog te verschijnen soloalbum.
The reason I released the my record is because there's not that much good music around nowadays.
He's right.
That's how my friends convince mm-hmm. me. It's like there's no good music around really now. So, like, the kids are, even though they're excited about the music that's out, I just think they're settling for something that doesn't have the same vibe as, like, Da Vinci. Like, to me, the really good music, like Jane's Addiction and Jimi Hendrix and just things of that caliber, has the same vibe as Da Vinci in my head. Like, there's something in it that ties together all artists from all times. Mm-hmm. And no bands around now really have it, you know? And mm-hmm. this music does, so I've released it.
Now I'm going to review his music on the Patreon one of these days. He's still a genius, though. He's a fucking genius. Beautiful singer. Beautiful man. Okay, yeah, I could jam this. I've jammed this before.
Na het eerste gesprek met John horen we van het bestaan van de film Stuff. We gaan terug naar Venice en vragen hem de film aan te kondigen.
Well, yeah, that was regurgitated content. I hope you learned a lot about the kind of music I enjoy. John Frusciante's had like this weird life where he's gone from Chili Pepper punk to drug ridden music to, back to the Chili Peppers to quitting them again and getting into electronic music. And if you're on the Patreon, you'll hear me talk more about John Frusciante, because I would like to review his albums, because he's had a lot of them and a lot of different albums. But if you get a chance, check out just John Frusciante's solo music. It's very different. It grows on you. And it's just, he's a very strange artist, because you could tell he only cares about the art and not really about anything else. But obviously there was a point where he cared about the drugs more, and I'm glad he wasn't like most of these stories go, and he ends up taking too much. But he's worth listening to. He's got the voice of an angel. He's got a whole brand new set of teeth. He could see those now. Brand new. They aren't yellow like that, like they used to be. But No, we'll talk more about John Frusciante. I always will. And I always praise. I think he's the best male musician, like, hands down, and male, like, artist, to me anyways. But thank you for watching. And, yeah, we'll do some more later. Take care.